Welcome everybody, you're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today we will access NESTED data using MongoLite. If you're unfamiliar, this is working in conjunction with R to interface with MongoDB. We will do some queries, aggregation, and MapReduce. All the code will be provided in the link in the description below to my GitHub. So, don't forget to subscribe and turn on that notification bell. Please like this video. If you don't like it, throw me a comment and tell me why before you decide to throw a thumbs down. I would appreciate it. We need to use the tidyverse knitter, markdown, and MongoLite libraries today. To refresh on what this data looks like, we use this in previous examples in our MongoDB series. All right, so what's going on here? If I was a recruiter and I had a database full of clients, and each client is a candidate where we have a first name, last name, a list of their skills, the state they live in, specialty, their experience level, and are they willing to relocate? All right, and you say, well, how's this nested? Well, because to access the data for each candidate, you have to call candidate dot and then whatever parameters you would like to access. All right, now we need to set up a Mongo connection. So I don't have any user credentials or anything like that, SSH connections, nothing like that. If you have those, you need to refer to the documentation for MongoDB and MongoLite to set that up. We're not doing that today. We have a collection where my collection is called Recruiter Clients and my DB is called Berkeley. Now, we create our connection, but you have to pay attention here, and I wanted to write this. I have a terminal open currently for MongoD, which is creating my connection, and then I'm able to access this because I don't have it running in the background all the time. I have to call it each time. That's just how I set up my interface. So if you have the same situation, pay attention to that, otherwise you're gonna end up with an error. So what we can do is we could call our Mongo connection and we could find everything with our query. But there's something interesting here. So I do a deep layer glimpse, and I have to call the candidate. This is similar to if I was in the Mongo shell and I did whatever the db.collection dot, and then this is replacing the dot, basically. So I called ahead, and this is all of my data, and that looks perfect. But what happens if I did the same thing, and I just called n? Well, you have something goofy here. Let's go back and close all of this real quick so we could, oh wait, not that one. So let's close this and this real fast. See what happens. So here you have an issue because it's saying, well, you have a length n or 7, but you're only calling one thing. And that's why I have to call this candidate to actually access the data. Okay, that's the issue with this when I'm calling anything that's nested, because it recognizes that there's other things that are attached to that. But I also have something here. From the last example that we did, I also did an update, and I allowed the modification to be shown. And so that's what's going on here, is that's what's showing. So enough of this playing around. Okay, so let's call our candidate. So just like if you're in the Mongo shell, let's look for a first name of someone named Brenda. And I say, all right, candidate.firstname. Then I call the person named Brenda. And I say, I want to do a field where I would like the first name to be true and just call that. And this is basically your query. You can also write just like this, and it's going to do the same thing. But what's up with this? I have this ID number instead of any actual data coming up. And that looks kind of weird, right? This was throwing me off with this stupid library, and I was like, I don't understand why I'm getting this printout. Well, you have to do something interesting. We can still run a regular count, and it provides our 500 documents. That's correct. But I run my query, and I find all fields. So it's basically telling me, I want to run this query and get all of the data that's associated with all the columns, basically. Well, I had to assign a variable, so I called it Brenda, and then I need to call the candidate because this is nested. So what else would be associated with Brenda? I could call the ID as well, right? So we could call the ID. We could pull the ID numbers that we found right here. So that's pretty useful. Okay. Well, what happens if we want to exclude some of these fields? All right. Well, we could just say, let's just take the first and the last name. And you have to call true. And then we'll call the last name. So for instance, if you didn't need all of the columns, first name, candidate, there we are. So since this was nested, I had to do the candidate dot first name, which is true, and the same for the last name if I wanted to show any particular fields. Then we could query it and say, let's look for only people who know Spark. All right. So then I run my query and I want all the fields. And this right here is letting me look only for people who know Spark, which is here. Okay. Perfect. Then I want to run a candidate who has the skill of C++, but not only C++, at least C++, or including C++, I should say. So we're running the same thing here, except we don't have the brackets. All right. So you can see C++, C++ for all of these. Okay, but what if we have an ID that we wanted to call? So we wanted one particular person and we know their ID at the time. That's okay. You can call the ID and then your colon, and then you'll need to use the dollar sign and then OID. And then you just call it if you have it and print it out like this. All right. And if you notice something that's interesting for all of this stuff that we're doing, we have our single quote, then we have our curly brace, and then we have to close it out with our right here, single quote and a curly brace, and then we'll call everything else. And in the Mongo shell, you don't need the strings surrounding your operators, but here you do. That's one of the distinctions you should pay attention to. Now, what about OR operators? Can we run that? Yeah, we could run OR and any of the same stuff. You just have to set it up a little different. So we call our query and we call the fields, and I'm going to call all of them. And let's zoom out a little bit. Okay. We're calling all of our fields. We have to just remember to do our single quotations and then call your curly braces and then put everything else that you want on the inside. And the only distinction, you have to make sure your operators are always enclosed by the strings. And you always have to enclose these within strings as well, just as well as these. All right. Now, let's say, let's find people, all the people who have Python as a skill. Okay. All right, that's cool. So we run this query and we use the all operator. But then if you notice something here, the use of this bracket before without the all only printed out the Python or the spark. Whereas here, we're finding all skills, including Python. So kind of similar to the C++ one that we did above. We could do an aggregation where we call the aggregate, and then this is all the same, except you got to remember, as always, you got to put in your single quote, but here you do not need to put the curly braces after the single quote. You still have to put the string around every operator, that operator, this operator, this, I guess it may be an operator, I don't know. And then you still have the same notation, except you have to enclose then, else, and if for this conditional and strings. And everything else is the same as MongoDB. So this aggregate is saying, let's project our data, taking the first name, the last name, where we're creating basically a count of all the skills that each person has. And so you're saying, let's use the condition if our skills is an array, then let's take the size of that array, basically count the number of elements in that list. Otherwise, if there isn't, just return NA, saying there is nothing there. But to call this, it's a little bit different. So let's see what's going on. Okay, so we could say, what do we call it? Skills count. Okay, so skills count, you run your dollar sign, which is basically equivalent to the dot in Python or the terminal commands. And then now you see that I have the IDs, I have a candidate as usual, and then I have our number skills that we just created. Okay, so in the terminal will be a little bit different because it would just all print out together, but here I have to do a column bind where I'm basically concatenating two columns of data or two data frames and just putting it together as one is basically what's going on here, so I could put out the same output as I would have in the terminal by just running this by itself. And unlike the terminal, you don't have to worry about these semicolons. Okay, so here we say each one of these people has a specific number of skills. Each person is different, just like in life, right? We could also do like a match similar to regular expressions where we're saying, let's find the candidates with the specialty of machine learning. And let's print all of those out. Where we're only doing as usual, remember the quotation around the operators and the single quotes here around the aggregate. And you do not need with aggregates the curly brace like you would use in the queries. Okay. Then we run a MapReduce. So then here it's MapReduce, one word, lowercase. And you have to call it like this, map equals reduce equals. In Mongo, you can, or the terminal or Python, you can just call it any way you want, you know, any function name. But here, you have to call it by these, otherwise I was getting an error. And I use almost the same notation, except when I was writing this in PyMongo or the Mongo shell, you'd have to do a variable name and then equals. But you don't have to use that notation here. So you just use your same functions, and you just place around them the single quotes and nothing else, and you just run that. And then to get your data back together, you have to do the if you want to put in a data frame, just do the cbind or cbind dot and then data frame, and you'll be good. Then I have this is interesting, so let me mention this. So for the MapReduce, you have an ID and the value. So your value is all of the counts, but your ID is your states here, which is interesting. That threw me off. Okay. And then if you want to name these columns, just designate it by your variable names here. So then you don't have to come back in and rename it after the fact. You just do it all at once. And then our last example here, we're doing another MapReduce where we're taking a function and we're looking at, I still need to do this variable name. I'm pretty sure. I use this function to say, let's look for our skills and let's print off all of the skills that people could have and count the number of occurrences that you have for each skill. That's what's going on in this. So just as you would have, as always, in your emit function, in your map function, you always have an emit. That's still the same as regular Mongo, and you still have this dot and then whatever you're calling. Those are still the same old things. Only thing is you're using your single quotes to place that around your function, and you don't need your variable equals here. You don't need that. That'll be the end of this video. I'd like to say thank you for watching. I hope it brought utility to somebody. Please like and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. Please don't throw me any dislikes. You know, throw me a comment with a critique in the comments. That's more beneficial for everyone. Thanks for watching. I appreciate it. See you in the next video. Bye.